In this video, we keep exploring the inexpressiveness of the formalists seen this far in the course. We will justify that this language is inherently ambiguous, that is, any grammar generating it is ambiguous. We proceed by contradiction supposing the existence of an unambiguous grammar G that generates it. With a loss of generality, we can assume that G is in Chomsky normal form, since we have already seen in this course that the transformation to Chomsky normal form preserves the non-ambiguity. As in the previous video, let n be the amount of variables in G and let's consider this word. We have 2 to the n plus 2 to the n factorial a's, also this same amount of b, and finally 2 to the n c's. There are less c's than a's and b's, but the same amount of a's and b's, and thus the word is in the language. This implies that there exists a derivation tree for it. Here it is. We have made explicit in the tree the path from the root to the first c. If we remove all the edges and nodes to the left of the path, this is the resulting tree. Note that this is not a correct derivation tree of the grammar, since we have removed a few nodes and edges. But it is a tree whose nodes have at most arity 2, with 2 to the n leaves, and where the nodes immediately over the leaves have arity 1. With similar reasoning to the previous video, it is easy to see that there exists a path from the root to a leaf with length greater than n. Therefore, there exists a path where a variable is repeated. We make it explicit in this way. This path also belongs to the original tree. It follows that there exists a derivation of this form, with this subderivation where W4 can only be composed with this, since it lies to the right of our specially chosen path. We can construct this new derivation iterating the subderivation from x. Analogously to how we did in the previous video, it follows that this word is in the language, that either W2 or W4 is not empty, and that both of them are composed with a single symbol. Recall that in our current example we already knew that W4 was composed by C's. But we can also deduce that W2 must be composed by C's, because if it were composed by, say, A's, then the word would have more A's than B's, and more B's than C's, and it would not be in the language. Therefore, W2W4 is composed by C's and it is not empty. Moreover, it is smaller than 2 to the n, since this is the amount of C's occurring in the original word. By iterating the subderivation from x, we can generate all the words of this kind. We choose this specific I. Note that this I is properly defined as a natural because 2 to the n factorial is divisible by all numbers less than or equal to 2 to the n. And we have already seen that the size of W2W4 is between 1 and 2 to the n. For this I, it follows that we will have inserted 2 to the n factorial new C's. In this case, the amount of A's, B's and C's matches, and therefore the generated word W must be this one. Now, let's take this other word. In this case, there are less A's than B's or C's, but the same amount of B's than C's, and thus the word is in the language. Therefore, there exists a derivation from S to this word. In this derivation, there cannot appear the variable x, because inserting this derivation, that adds more c's, we could cause that the word had more c's than b's and more b's than a's, and it would no longer be in the language. If we proceed analogously to the previous word, we can iterate one of its subderivations until we obtain again a derivation of this word. But in this case, the variable x does not appear in the derivation. Thus, the current derivation tree is different from the one obtained before for this same word. Summarizing, we have obtained two different derivation trees for the same word, and this contradicts the initial assumption of the non-ambiguity of G.